Why the hell do you have to be so critical?
I'm a critic.
No, your job is to rate movies on a scale from good to excellent.
What if I don't like them?
That's what good's for.
It's fun to be critical, but I also love to just lose myself in a good movie. Movies have the power to move us on a deeply personal level. A good movie can do so much more than just entertain. The format itself can be a vehicle for new ideas and concepts, or it can show us a perspective that we might not otherwise consider or care about. But there is something I love to lose myself in even more than a good movie. A bad movie.
Tonight's forecast. A freeze is coming.
Now, when I say bad, I'm not talking about the childish storylines, shallow characters, and god-awful special effects that dominate modern movie making. I'm talking about movies that are so bad, they're actually good. On the face of things, this might seem like a contradiction in terms, but stick with me here. Just like an actually good movie, a good bad movie can give us a new perspective on why we like film in the first place. And there's one bad movie that will always have a special place in my heart. The 1994 live-action Street Fighter.
Of course!
The live-action Street Fighter is an exquisitely bad movie. The acting is incredibly hammy.
What's the matter, gentlemen? Surely you're not afraid of your own weapons.
Despite the for its time gigantic budget of $35 million, the sets and special effects still look cheap as hell. And the protagonist of the film, the main character we're all supposed to care about, is just incomprehensible.
Colonel, you can't!
Oh yes, I can. Just take the hostages out. If I'm not topside in 15 minutes, evacuate without me.
But all of that pales in comparison to Raul Julia's turn as the gloriously campy antagonist, General M. Bison.
Game over!
Intruder destroyed.
The technology of East and West. While their governments scorned me, their corporations adored me.
Every creed, every nation. Until the very planet is in the loving grip of the Pax Bisonica.
It's not overstating things to say that he single-handedly redeems the entire movie, and then some. But we'll get to that later. Because when you learn just how messy and troubled the production of this movie was, you start to realize that it was a miracle it got made at all. The year was 1993, and Japan's campaign to dominate global pop culture was in full swing. For decades, the Japanese government had spent a considerable amount of money and effort to cultivate the Land of the Rising Sun status as a cultural superpower, what's known today as Cool Japan. Nintendo's NES and SNES consoles had just captured the imagination of the world and defined the contours of an emerging art form. The rising tide of global interest in all things Japan led several American movie studios to explore the possibility of adapting a Japanese video game to the silver screen. Enter Capcom. The game development studio had a bona fide blockbuster smash on their hands with Street Fighter II, which had sold millions of copies on console and helped revitalize the arcade industry of the early 90s. Capcom had just seen Nintendo attract big money and major studio talent for the Super Mario Bros. Movie, and they wanted in on the action. In December 1993, Capcom greenlit a pitch by Universal Pictures to produce a live-action Street Fighter movie. But there was a catch, and it was a big one. The movie would need to be shot, edited, and completely produced and ready for release by Christmas of 1994, barely more than a year away. You couldn't get a big-name director to say yes to a shooting schedule like that, so Universal Studios had no choice but to roll the dice. They hired Steven D'Souza, a Hollywood screenwriter who didn't have a single directing credit to his name. Now, D'Souza wasn't a total movie newbie. From 1982 to 1992, he wrote a string of screenplays that went on to be bona fide blockbusters. Universal and Capcom hoped that what he lacked in directing experience, he'd make up for with his knack for snappy dialogue and his imagination for big-budget action movie spectacle.
Then you're ready for Captain Freedom's workout.
Yes, it's America's own Captain Freedom.
That's the ticket. No pain, no gain.
So, when you hear the tone, control your jealousy and leave your message.
D'Souza quickly threw together a script, with the main characters from the Street Fighter video game filling in the lead roles. Guile would star as the leader of an international task force and recruit Cammy, Chun-Li, Ken, Ryu, and all the others to infiltrate the secret lair of M. Bison, a rogue dictator armed with WMDs and ambitions for global domination. The executives at Capcom loved it. And just like that, a relative nobody was given a $35 million budget and the keys to one of the most lucrative video game franchises in history. With such a compressed production schedule and a greenhorn director running the project, it was inevitable that they'd start running into problems. For one, by the time the crew was flying out to Bangkok, Thailand for initial shooting and production, the movie still hadn't been fully cast. One of the lead roles, Cammy, wouldn't be filled by the Australian actor Kylie Minogue for several weeks. And then there was another problem. Raul Julia, the actor playing the supervillain antagonist M. Bison, had just been treated for stomach cancer and was dangerously underweight. And the cast and crew didn't know it yet, but Julia's cancer was terminal. This meant there'd need to be serious changes to the entire production schedule of the movie. In action movies, up-close dialogue and simple scenes are usually shot first to give the actors and crew time to rehearse the more complicated action sequences. But Julia had lost so much weight and had such low energy after his surgery that doing the up-close dialogue shots just wasn't an option. And so, the crew flipped the production schedule. The complicated action sequences and wire-fighting stunts would be filmed first, so Julia could be shot from further away. And after he recovered from his treatment and put on a little more weight, they'd do the up-close dialogue scenes. This compressed production schedule, combined with the movie basically being shot in reverse, meant that there was no time to rehearse scenes or block stunts. The crew had to choreograph most of the stunts entirely on the fly, while the actors were forced to improvise their dialogue, sometimes the same day they were filming. From the moment production began in Bangkok, the movie encountered problem after problem. Cast members got sick from eating the local cuisine and drinking untreated water. The film's mainline producer had a heart attack and had to be replaced halfway through filming. One of the actors even got busted at the airport for steroids. Less than a month into shooting, the film was already 15 days behind schedule. As the cast relocated from Thailand to Australia to complete secondary shooting, they got some more bad news. Capcom and Universal had set a hard release date of December 23, 1994 for the film, and their request for extra production time was denied. But through some miracle of blood, sweat, and pure grit, the team managed to finish the movie and get it to the editors on time. The movie released in time for Christmas 1994 to pretty harsh reviews from critics. But despite the lukewarm domestic box office numbers, the movie was a smash hit internationally, bringing in huge ticket sales. This ugly duckling of a movie, this little engine that could, was a bona fide success.
Change the channel!
In 1962, the American writer Susan Sontag published the essay On Camp, where she defined a new and emerging artistic sensibility. In opposition to the traditional values of elite taste and so-called high culture, camp celebrated irony, bad taste, and subverting the status quo. Camp isn't just some academic term that was dreamed up a decade after the fact. It was a legitimate artistic sensibility and movement, one that gave us some of the greatest cult classics of the 20th century. The Adam West Batman TV show? That's camp. Doctor Who, back when it didn't take itself quite so seriously? Pure camp. Tim Curry's entire career? Quintessential camp.
Halloween, your blood begins to run. Brooklyn Spook is going down low.
In On Camp, Sontag laid out 58 rules defining this new style. As she argues in her final rule and the final paragraph of the essay, the ultimate camp statement, it's good because it's awful. So bad, it's good.
For I beheld Satan as he fell from heaven like lightning!
On a surface level, the live-action Street Fighter fits neatly into Sontag's definition of camp. The dialogue is gloriously cheesy, thanks in no small part to JCVD's mush-mouthed Belgian accent.
Going to kick that son of a bitch Bison's ass so hard that the next Bison wannabe is gonna feel it.
Some of the high-flying wire stunts look great, but others... And the plot itself is all over the place. They were clearly aiming for a James Bond-style spy thriller, but instead they got a mishmash of a war movie, wushu, wirefu martial arts, and weird sci-fi. But as enjoyable as it all is in the aggregate, there's so much more to recommend the live-action Street Fighter movie than just camp. Despite the pre-production pratfalls, Jean-Claude Van Damme is a genuinely great stunt actor, and his choreography in this movie is nothing short of impressive. His performance is even more extraordinary when you remember that he sometimes had to plan out these stunts literally the same day they were shot. And it's clear that the actors and crew weren't taking themselves too seriously. This movie's unwavering commitment to its breezy and adventurous tone, to fun above all else, is a joy to behold. In fairness to the team that made this movie, a lot of that is down to the surprisingly sharp editing that was done after shooting was wrapped. The editing does most of the heavy lifting for the handful of truly charming moments that pepper the film.
That's great news, General. Congratulations.
On the contrary, I mourn.
Okay.
But the real star of this movie, and let's be honest, the reason you're probably watching this video right now, is Raul fucking Julia.
Showtime!
By the time he had been cast in this movie, Julia was already famous as a serious, classically trained actor. He rose to international acclaim as one of the leads of the Oscar-winning 1983 drama, Kiss of the Spider-Woman. And prior to Street Fighter, he had won America's heart as Gomez Adams in the 1991 movie adaptation of The Addams Family. But Julia puts all of his past work to shame with his show-stealing turn as M. Bison, a megalomaniacal madman who is equal parts Stalin and Shakespeare.
A beast born of my own genius!
You can see it in his demeanor as he prowls the stage, fully inhabiting this role like he's method acting his goddamn heart out. Most of my friends in high school were over-earnest theater geeks, but I've still never seen anyone dedicate themselves to a role the way Julia dedicated himself to Street Fighter.
That was beautiful.
Which makes it all the more incredible when you consider that the months of filming Street Fighter were the final months of Julia's life. He basically arrived on set right after chemotherapy, and must have been in incredible pain throughout the entire production. And despite it all, he still refused to use a body double and did all of his own stunts. But even more amazing is the apocryphal story behind why Raul Julia, this highly respected and distinguished actor, took the role of M. Bison in the first place.
My children play the video game, and as soon as I mentioned the title of the film, all of a sudden their faces lit up.
He took the role for one reason, and one reason only. He loved his kids. His two children, Raul and Benjamin, loved the Street Fighter games. He did it as a present for them, his dying gift. At the end of his life, all he wanted was to be a good father to his sons. The worst kind of bad movie is the cynical kind. The soulless cash grab, the needless and unnecessary sequel, the reboot remake that nobody asked for. But the best kind of bad movie is enjoyable for the same reason a good movie is. There's an obvious dedication and love of the craft on the part of the people who made it. That kind of soul always shines through, no matter how schlocky or tasteless the finished product is. Also, the footage I'm showing right now is entirely unrelated to that last point. Street Fighter may never get a release in the Criterion Collection, but that doesn't mean it isn't every bit as enjoyable and worthwhile. Like all of the truly great bad movies, Street Fighter reminds us that we can find meaning, and even joy, in the most unlikely places.